Excuse me, for the record, the matter before the court is the State of New Hampshire versus Kayla Montgomery. Counsel, please identify yourselves for the record.
Good afternoon, Jesse O'Neill for the state.
Your Honor, good afternoon. Paul Garrity for Kayla Montgomery.
All right, good afternoon. Go ahead.
The matter before the court is a plea and sentence, and Ms. Montgomery, would you stand, please? Please raise your right hand to the best of your ability. Do you swear that the testimony you're about to give will be the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth?
Yes.
Thank you, Ms. Montgomery. Please state your name for the record.
Kayla Montgomery.
Thank you.
All right, Ms. Montgomery, it's my understanding it's your intention today to plead guilty to two felony counts of perjury. Is that correct?
Yes.
All right. We're going to start by having the state review for the court and for you the sentences that are being recommended to the court today. These are the sentences that will be imposed, so please listen carefully and make sure this is your understanding as well. You can be seated, and I'll turn to the state. And I should just say, Attorney O'Neill, the sentencing addendum doesn't have any charge IDs on it. I am going to have the clerk's office put both charge IDs on it. As I understand it, it applies to both sentences. That's the party's understanding?
It does.
It is, Your Honor.
All right. Go ahead.
So beginning with the state prison sentence sheet for charge ID 198-2119C, the proposed sentence is that on this charge ID, the defendant be sentenced to the New Hampshire State Prison for not more than 7 years nor less than 3.5 years. There is added to the minimum sentence a disciplinary period equal to 150 days for each year of the minimum term of the defendant's sentence to be prorated for any part of the year. There is 197 days pretrial confinement credit. This sentence is to be served as follows: stand committed, commencing today. 1.5 years of the minimum sentence and none of the maximum sentence is suspended. Suspensions are conditioned upon good behavior and compliance with all of the terms of this order. Any suspended sentence may be imposed after your hearing at the request of the state. The suspended sentence begins today. Excuse me. The suspended sentence begins today and ends 10 years from her release on this charge. The court recommends to the Department of Corrections that they screen and or assess the defendant for drug and alcohol treatment needs. The defendant is to participate meaningfully in and complete any counseling, treatment, and educational programs as directed by the correctional authority or probation parole officer, subject to the provisions of RSA 651-A, Section 22-A. The Department of Corrections shall have the authority to award the defendant earned time reductions against the minimum and maximum sentences for successful completion of programming while incarcerated. Law enforcement agencies may destroy the evidence or return the evidence to its rightful owner. The defendant is ordered to be of good behavior and comply with all the terms of this sentence. And then there's an additional 5-page sentencing addendum slash memorandum of agreement, which has been signed by both the defendant and the state, which is incorporated by reference and included as part of this sentencing order as fully stated herein. Without reading the 5 pages of that agreement, and perhaps most significant to this particular charge ID, is that the state is in agreement on this charge ID that the state will take no position on a motion to suspend the balance of the maximum sentence after 3 years release, as long as none of the suspended time has been imposed either on this charge or the other charge, 198-2120C. There is no pending request to impose any of the suspended time on this charge or 198-2120C, and the defendant has been of good behavior and in compliance with all terms and conditions of her sentence, including those made part of the sentence through the sentencing addendum. On charge ID number 198-2120C, the proposed sentence is that the defendant be sentenced to the New Hampshire State Prison for not more than 7 years nor less than 3.5 years. On that charge, there would be no pretrial confinement credit. All of that sentence, all of the minimum and all of the maximum sentence is suspended, conditioned upon good behavior and compliance with all terms of the order. Any suspended sentence may be imposed after a hearing at the request of the state. The suspended sentence begins today and ends 10 years from her release on the other charge, 198-2119C. This sentence on 198-2120C is to run consecutive to any sentence on 198-2119C. It also includes the same conditions, the recommendation that DOC screen or assess the defendant for drug and alcohol treatment needs, that she participate in the counseling, treatment, and educational programs, the box for the earned time reductions, and that she be ordered to be of good behavior and comply with all the terms of this sentence, including the same 5-page sentencing addendum slash memorandum of agreement, which is also incorporated by reference and included as part of this sentence as it fully stated therein.
Ms. Montgomery, are the terms of the sentences that were just reviewed for you by the state, are those the terms of the sentence that you understand will be imposed today if the court accepts them?
Yes.
And the state did not read in its entirety all of the five-page memorandum of agreement between you and the state of New Hampshire. Did you review that carefully with your counsel?
Yes.
And did you read that yourself, or did he read that to you?
I read it myself.
Okay. And Ms. Montgomery, how old are you?
I'm 32 years old.
And how far did you go in school?
I got my GED.
So you reviewed that addendum in its entirety and you discussed it with Attorney Garrity, is that correct?
Yes.
So you understand everything that's in that addendum?
Yes.
And all of what your obligations are within that addendum and all of the consequences should you not comply, is that right?
Yes.
Did you have any question about that?
No.
Okay. What we're going to do now is the state's going to tell me the facts that the state would rely on if these matters were to go to trial. Please listen carefully because I'm going to ask you if you have any disagreement with those facts, and I do that in part so that I know you're acknowledging your guilt on those specific charges. So please listen carefully to the state. Attorney O'Neill?
Had this case proceeded to trial, the state would have introduced evidence to prove the following beyond a reasonable doubt. On December 28th of 2021, the Manchester Police Department began an investigation into the disappearance of Harmony Montgomery, who would have been 7 years old at that time. The police soon learned that the last credible reports of anyone seeing Harmony were from November of 2019, when Harmony was 5 years old. The police learned that in November of 2019, Harmony was living with her father, Adam Montgomery, the defendant, who was Adam's wife, but who is not biologically related to Harmony, and two common children of Adam and the defendant. Fast forwarding back to December of 2021, during a voluntary interview with Manchester police detectives, the defendant told detectives that she had last seen Harmony 2 days after Thanksgiving in 2019, which would have been November 30th of 2019. In that interview, the defendant said on that date, Adam dropped her, the defendant, off for a 6 a.m. to 2 p.m. shift at the Dunkin' Donuts on Eddy Road in Manchester. She said when Adam dropped her off, he told her he was bringing Harmony to Harmony's mother, and the defendant told police at that time that she didn't see Harmony again after that. That was in December of 2021. In May of 2022, Harmony had still not been located, and investigators still had no definite information about her whereabouts or at that time whether she was even dead or alive. So that month, May of 2022, to further the investigation, the defendant was subpoenaed to appear before the grand jury for Hillsborough County Northern District. The grand jury was investigating possible charges related to Harmony's disappearance. The defendant was subpoenaed to testify about the last time she saw Harmony and anything else relevant she knew about Harmony's disappearance. The defendant's date to testify before the grand jury was May 20th of 2022. She was accompanied on that date by her attorney, Attorney Garrity, who waited outside of the grand jury room during the defendant's testimony per grand jury regulations. However, the defendant was advised at the beginning of her testimony that she could request a break at any point to consult with Attorney Garrity. The defendant was questioned during her grand jury testimony by Associate Attorney General Jeffrey Strelzin. Prior to any questioning, the defendant was sworn by AAG Strelzin pursuant to RSA Chapter 600, Section 4. Prior to any substantive questioning, Attorney Strelzin informed the defendant that she had the right to refuse to answer any question if it would incriminate her, that any answer she gave to the grand jury could be used against her in court, and that if she lied to the grand jury, she could be charged with perjury, which he told her was a Class B felony punishable by up to 3.5 to 7 years in prison and a $4,000 fine. The defendant indicated that she understood these things and that she had no questions. During the defendant's grand jury testimony, Attorney Strelzin asked her about the last time she saw Harmony. While under oath, the defendant testified initially that a day or two after Thanksgiving of 2019, Adam dropped her, the defendant, off at work, and Harmony and the other two children were in the car. The defendant testified that at that time, Adam said he was bringing Harmony to Harmony's mother. The defendant testified that this happened during the morning because she worked 6 to 2, and she said she was working at Dunkin' Donuts. Attorney Strelzin then advised the defendant that the police had checked with Dunkin' Donuts and had records that she wasn't working at Dunkin' Donuts at the time. Attorney Strelzin then again warned the defendant that whatever she said could be used against her, and he told her to really think about that day and where she was because she had to tell the truth. Subsequent to that warning, the defendant testified that 2 days after Thanksgiving 2019, before 6 in the morning, Adam dropped her off where she was working at Dunkin' Donuts in Goffstown. The defendant testified that Adam picked her up from work later that day, which she said was a little after 2 p.m., and that it was only the other two children and Adam in the car, and that Harmony was not in the car. The defendant testified that at that time she asked Adam if he had brought Harmony to Harmony's mom, and he said that he had. At no point during her grand jury testimony did the defendant retract or change her testimony that the last time she saw Harmony was 2 days after Thanksgiving of 2019, when Adam dropped the defendant off for her 6 a.m. to 2 p.m. shift at Dunkin' Donuts in Goffstown. After the defendant's grand jury testimony, Manchester detectives investigated her claim that she was working at Dunkin' Donuts in Goffstown on November 30th of 2019 from 6 a.m. to 2 p.m. Detectives learned that there were three Dunkin' Donuts locations in Goffstown, two on Mast Road and one on Tower Lane. Ownership of the two Mast Road locations informed detectives that the defendant never worked at either of those locations. Ownership of the Tower Lane location informed detectives that the defendant had worked there from August 4th of 2019 to September 11th of 2019, but did not work there after September 11th of 2019. Detectives also obtained the defendant's employment records from New Hampshire Employment Security. Those records showed that the only employer who paid the defendant in the fourth quarter of 2019, which would have been October, November, and December of 2019, was the owner of the Dunkin' Donuts located at 6 Bell Avenue in Hooksett. When contacted, ownership of the Bell Avenue Dunkin' Donuts informed detectives that the defendant had worked there, but only until November 23rd of 2019. Detectives also received a copy of paperwork signed by the defendant herself, which confirmed that November 23rd of 2019 was her last date at that location. In sum, the evidence the state would introduce at trial would show that the defendant was not working at any Dunkin' Donuts location for any shift, neither in Goffstown or anywhere else, on November 30th of 2019, which means the defendant's testimony under oath before the grand jury for Hillsborough County Northern District on May 20th of 2022 about where she was working and the shift she was working was false.
Ms. Montgomery, do you have any disagreement with the facts as just stated by the prosecutor?
No.
You went over the acknowledgement and waiver of rights form for a felony with Attorney Garrity, is that correct?
Yes.
And again, I ask you, did you read them yourself, or did he read them to you, or both?
Both.
So do you understand that you're giving up certain constitutional rights you have by deciding to plead guilty today?
Yes.
You understand you'd have the right to a speedy and public jury trial of this matter?
Yes.
Did Attorney Garrity tell you how many people would sit on a jury if you went to a jury trial?
Yes.
How many?
15.
Well, that's close. 12. You would have 12 people who would deliberate to determine guilt or innocence. We often would add two or three additional jurors who would serve as alternates. Of the 12 deliberating jurors, do you know how many of those jurors would have to say you're guilty or for a finding of guilty to be entered against you? If you're uncertain of that, you can speak with Attorney Garrity.
Judge.
All 12.
That's correct. And Ms. Montgomery, I ask you these questions because it's important that I know that you understand the rights that you're giving up by deciding to plead guilty today. And as indicated on that form, you would have the right to a unanimous jury verdict, but you are giving up that right by deciding to plead guilty today. Is that what you want to do?
Yes.
Okay. Do you understand that that also means you're giving up your right to question any of the witnesses in this case that the state would bring in against you?
Yes.
And you're giving up your right to present evidence or call witnesses that could be favorable to you. Do you understand that?
Yes.
You're also giving up your right. If you went to a trial, you'd have the right to testify, but you'd also have the right to remain silent. You could choose to say nothing at all, and the jury would be instructed they can't assume you're guilty because of that. But by deciding to plead guilty today, you are giving up that right to remain silent. Do you understand that?
Yes.
And you're giving up your right to challenge any of the evidence in this case, even if you believe that there was evidence that was taken in violation of your rights. Do you understand that?
Yes.
And if you went forward to trial, it would be the state's obligation to prove your guilt beyond a reasonable doubt before you could be found guilty of these charges. Do you understand that?
Yes.
You are also giving up your right to have Attorney Garrity continue to defend you and present any defenses that you might have at a trial. Do you understand that?
Yes.
And importantly, you're also giving up your right to appeal. So once we go forward today, if I take your plea and enter a conviction on these charges, you won't have any right to appeal this. Do you understand?
Yes.
And do you want to give up all these rights that we've just discussed and all the other rights on that acknowledgement and waiver of rights form of your own free will?
Yes.
Has anybody threatened, forced, or coerced you to enter a plea today against your will?
No.
Has anybody made any promises to you other than the promise of the recommended sentences that have just been reviewed with you?
No.
And do you feel you've had enough time to discuss this with Attorney Garrity?
Yes.
Did you tell him all the facts about this case so he could advise you?
Yes.
Did he answer all of your questions?
Yes.
Are you satisfied with his services?
Yes.
Attorney Garrity, did you go over each and every element of the offenses charged and any possible defenses that Ms. Montgomery might have with her?
I did, Your Honor.
And did you carefully go over the acknowledgement and waiver of rights form and waiver of sentence review forms in their entirety with her?
Multiple times, Your Honor.
And do you believe that this is a knowing, intelligent, and voluntary waiver on her part?
I believe it is.
Ms. Montgomery, do you have any mental health or other physical condition that affects your judgment or your thinking in any way?
No.
Have you taken any medication, drugs, or alcohol in the last 24 hours?
No.
Judge, did your attorney advise you?
Not to cut you off, Your Honor.
Yes.
She's on MAT at the jail.
Okay. So, Ms. Montgomery, it's my understanding that you take some medications for a substance use disorder. Is that correct?
Yes.
And how long have you been on that medication?
7 years.
Okay. And when was the last time that you took it?
Yesterday at 12:30 p.m.
Okay. And it was taken only as prescribed?
Yes.
And do you feel that in any way that affects the clarity of your thinking today?
No.
So you feel that you're thinking clearly and you know what you're doing?
Yes.
Okay. And I ask this of everyone. Did your attorney advise you that if you're not a United States citizen, you can suffer other consequences of this plea up to and including deportation?
Yes.
Now, Ms. Montgomery, you also went over the waiver of sentence review form with Attorney Garrity. Is that correct?
Yes.
And did he explain to you that because you're getting a state prison sentence, you would have the right to have that sentence reviewed by a panel of three judges, and they could increase your sentence, decrease it, or keep it the same?
Yes.
But it's my understanding that both you and the state have agreed to waive sentence review as part of this negotiated agreement. Is that correct?
Yes.
All right. I will take your plea on these charges. On charge ID 1982119C, charging you with Class B felony of perjury, carrying a maximum penalty of 3.5 to 7 years at the New Hampshire State Prison and a $4,000 fine, which states that Kayla Montgomery did commit the crime of perjury and that Kayla Montgomery, in an official proceeding as defined by RSA 64112, did make a false material statement under oath or affirmation, and she did not believe the statement to be true, to wit, on or about May 20th, 2022, while testifying under oath before the grand jury for Hillsborough County Northern District. Kayla Montgomery testified falsely regarding a prior work location. How do you plead to that, guilty or not guilty?
Guilty.
And on charge ID 1982120C, charging you with perjury, carrying a maximum penalty of 3.5 to 7 years at the New Hampshire State Prison and a $4,000 fine, which states that Kayla Montgomery, in an official proceeding as defined by RSA 64112, did make a false material statement under oath or affirmation, and she did not believe the statement to be true, to wit, on or about May 20th, 2022, while testifying under oath before the grand jury for Hillsborough County Northern District. Kayla Montgomery testified falsely regarding the time of the prior work shift. How do you plead to that, guilty or not guilty?
Guilty.
Court finds there's a factual basis for these charges, and having questioned you, Ms. Montgomery, and your counsel on your offer of your plea of guilty, you and your counsel having informed the court that you've discussed all aspects of these matters and any defenses that you might have, and having observed you today as you've answered my questions, your demeanor, apparent intelligence, and attitude, and observing that you do not appear to be under the influence of any substance today that might affect your judgment, the court finds that this is a knowing, intelligent, and voluntary waiver of your rights, and your guilty pleas are accepted. Is there anything the state would like to add before sentencing?
No, Judge, I'd just like to note that the proposed sentence was carefully negotiated over an extended period of time between the parties, and does provide benefits to each party, and I would ask the court to accept the sentence.
Okay. I guess the only other thing, Attorney O'Neill, I did ask Ms. Montgomery whether there were any other promises made, it's my understanding that the additional outstanding charges that are pending against her in the other cases are being nullprost as a condition of compliance with the sentencing addendum and the sentences that are being offered today. Is that correct?
That's correct, and that's included in the memorandum of agreement, so it's part of what she said was the sentence that she's agreeing to.
Okay, thank you. Attorney Garrity, anything you would like to add?
Judge, just to echo what the state said, both sides engaged in extensive negotiations. This agreement gives benefits both to the state and to Ms. Montgomery, most importantly, from our perspective. We would ask that you accept the proposed plea agreement and proposed sentence.
All right, thank you. Ms. Montgomery, is there anything you would like to say?
No.
All right. The court is aware from prior proceedings that the parties have worked diligently to come to a negotiated agreement. Ms. Montgomery, it is obviously contingent on a number of commitments on your part as set forth in the sentencing addendum. Based upon all of the information that's been provided to the court will accept the recommended sentences. So with respect to the prison terms on the charge ID ending in 119C, you will have that 3.5 to 7 year state prison sentence with the pretrial confinement of 197 days. That's stand committed, commencing forthwith. 1.5 years of the minimum and none of the maximum are suspended on that sentence. The suspended period is suspended for a period of 10 years from the date of your release. All of the other conditions that were reviewed with you earlier and are within that sentencing memorandum are also imposed. Do you have any question about that?
No.
Okay. On charge ID ending in 120C, on that charge you also will receive a sentence of not more than 7 years nor less than 3.5 years at the New Hampshire State Prison. All of that sentence, both the minimum and maximum, are suspended. Those suspensions are conditioned upon your good behavior and compliance with all the terms and conditions of the sentencing order. That suspended sentence will begin today and end 10 years after your release on charge ID 119C. If this sentence were to be imposed, it would be consecutive to the sentence in 119C. All of the other conditions that I reviewed with you earlier, as well as the conditions within the 5-page sentencing addendum and memorandum of agreement, are also imposed in connection with that sentence. Do you have any question about that?
No.
All right. So those sentences and all of the conditions are imposed. Attorney Garrity, the court needs to make a determination on attorney's fees. Has her conditions changed since she completed, maybe she didn't complete, let me just see.
Judge, at one point, while she was out on bail, it had changed to some extent, but obviously now that she's detained, it's back to what it was previously.
Okay, so she does not have any money
in
accounts.
That's correct.
And does not own any property?
No.
Okay. Under the circumstances, the court will find that you do not have an obligation of your attorney's fees in these cases, taking into consideration those factors as well as the fact that you will be incarcerated for a period of time going forward. If you have attorney's fees obligations from other cases, you still will have those. All right? You're all set, everyone. Thank you.
Thank you, Ron.
Court.
Okay, Mr. Brown.